Good morning. If I can have everybody's attention for a moment, we'll get started. I'm Tim Murphy. I'm the president of the board of Franklin Tomorrow here in Franklin. And Mindy, our executive director, Mindy Tate, is not here today. She's in Canada on vacation. So she's enjoying staying on a lake. And she's seen a couple of pictures of the view, and it's spectacular. But I want to welcome all of you today. I want to thank you all for coming out. We've got a very interesting program today. And we have the, but before I introduce Dr. Teets, I want to give a couple of thanks here. Of course, as you guys, some of you are regulars at Frank Talk, but for those of you, it's your first time. If it's the first or second Tuesday of the month, there's usually going to be a Frank Talks happening somewhere in Franklin. We have them around at different locations. We want to thank Mary Lee Bennett and West Haven for hosting hosting us today. And we've been here before, or some of you have been before. But just check our website, franklintomorrow.org, for different different dates and different locations. And if you want to be a regular to receive the notices, you can go online, or you can get with Carmen, who is our administrative manager, and or Mindy, you know, when she gets back. But we do want to thank Lynn Maddox and the Vanderbilt University Office of Neighborhood, Government, and Community Relations for being one of our partners. We also want to thank Coffee and Coconuts for providing the coffee today. They're one of our new partners. And again, we want to thank West Haven for hosting us today. And so with all of the pleasantries out of the way, it's my privilege to introduce and tell you a little bit about Dr. Billy Teets. He's the outreach astronomer for the Vanderbilt Dyer Observatory. And Dr. Teets got his undergraduate at Austin Peay, I think, and his PhD at Vanderbilt. And he is here to tell us or to talk to us about this big upcoming event and probably gonna answer some questions of yours. So without any further ado, I'm gonna turn it over to Dr. Teets.
All right, well, thank you all for having me today. Everybody in the back hear me all right? If you can't, just give me a thumbs up or some motion, let me know you can't hear me. Just a quick announcement. We do have solar eclipse classes, one for each person here today. We'll have these available at the end of the talk, okay? And these are the approved ones, and we'll talk about some of the issues with some of the glasses that are being sold, okay? All right, so I'd like to start out with this image here. This was a view of the 2015 eclipse. It actually took place over northern Norway. This was actually taken about I believe it was about 10 degrees from the North Pole. So, I mean, we're getting pretty far north there, but it's a really spectacular image. I mean, I'm a big fan of snow, so I, of course, love this image. But just to top it off, that beautiful eclipse there, I mean, that's just a really spectacular view to me. But this is basically what you would have seen if you were standing out there with those folks watching this eclipse. One of the good friends of the observatory who chases these eclipses and has seen a number of total solar eclipses has said that even though this is, you know, a spectacular image, he has not seen any image that really conveys the beauty and the splendor of a total solar eclipse. So that really gets me excited for something like this. So our talk today will be in three basic sections. We'll do a little bit of background about the different types of eclipses, the different types of solar eclipses, and we'll touch just a minute or two on lunar eclipses as well, because they are actually linked to solar eclipses, and we'll discuss how. We'll definitely talk about specifics for the August 21st eclipse, especially where you need to be, when you need to be there, what you can expect to see, and then finally, and most importantly, viewing the eclipse safely. We are, after all, for about 3 hours going to be looking up at the sun when it's at least partially exposed. So we need to make sure that we've got the right equipment and we're using the equipment properly. Because if you don't, you can suffer severe eye damage. So let's just do a little bit of background on the eclipses here. So We have two diagrams for a lunar eclipse at the top and a solar eclipse at the bottom. And we've got the sun on the left, Earth here, and then depending on the type of eclipse, we either have the moon to the left or to the right of the Earth. So I'll focus on the lunar eclipse just for a second because it's easier to see the shadows. So if you look at the shadows of the Earth here, and imagine that we have taken a slice through the shadows. Okay? So this shadow up here actually arcs around, and it's actually that shadow as well. Okay, so we're just taking a slice right through it. This lighter outer shadow is known as the penumbra. If you're standing in the penumbra of either the Earth or the Moon, you will see a partially obscured sun. But then you'll notice there's this deeper, darker shadow, this inner shadow, that we call the umbra. And that's where you have to be standing in order to observe a total eclipse. Now, if you look down here at the solar eclipse diagram, the moon, being smaller, is going to have smaller shadows. But if you really pay attention to that umbra there, that inner shadow, you'll notice that it makes a nice cone shape, but it's really just the tip of that cone that is reaching our planet, which means that the path that cone is going to trace across our planet is going to be very small. Oh, yes. Yeah. Everybody?
Yeah.
Okay. Now you can actually see what I'm talking about. All right. Let me scoot it over just a tad here. I'm kind of off the side. All right. So again, we've got this inner shadow here, which is going to be really important for us on August 21st. Because again, you can see just how narrow that tip of that shadow is once it reaches our planet. Okay, so that's going to be tracing out a very narrow path as it goes across the surface of the Earth. We've got to be in that path in order to see the total solar eclipse. Two other things about this diagram. What phase would the moon have to be in for a solar eclipse to occur?
Full.
Had to be in, I heard full and I heard new. One of those answers is correct. Who says new? Everybody raise your hand. It's new, okay? So it's going to be the new moon phase. Now, what phase would we have to have for a lunar eclipse? That one would have to be the full phase. So how often do we have those phases? On average? Once a month. Okay, it's about every 29 and a half days. But basically a month. On average, how often do we have some sort of eclipse that is visible from the Earth, any portion of the Earth? I think I heard about every 3 months?
18 months.
18 months? Anybody else? So on average, it's about every 5.5 to 6 months. So let's talk a little bit about why that is. So imagine that the Earth is stationary and the sun actually goes around us. Obviously, that's completely backwards, but just assume that for the moment. Or just imagine that this is the path. This blue line is the path of the sun through our sky. Right, that's easier to see. This red line can represent the orbit of the moon around the Earth, or the path of the moon through our sky. Those two paths do not lie on top of one another. There is just a very small angle, and it's been exaggerated here, but there's a tilt between those two paths, and it's only about 5 degrees, so not very much, but that has an effect on our eclipses. So for most new moons, so the moon would be at the new moon phase in this view because it's going to be coming in between us and the sun, but for most new moons, because of that tilt of the moon's orbit, the moon is either a little bit too high or a little bit too low in the sky for it to pass in front of the sun. Or in other words, the shadows that the moon is casting completely miss the Earth. And then likewise, about 2 weeks later, when the moon gets around to this side of its orbit, reaches full moon, and we try to have a lunar eclipse, typically the moon is too low or too high that it misses the shadows of the Earth. And so we just have a regular full moon. But you'll notice that there are two points where those paths intersect. And those are referred to as the nodes. So if we have the sun at one node, and we have the moon at a node, then we will have some sort of eclipse. If we have our sun, let's say right down here at this node, and our moon comes around in its orbit to arrive at that node as well, the moon will be directly in between us and the sun. We will have a solar eclipse. Now, it takes about 365 days for the sun to traverse this path. Okay. Now, obviously, the sun's going to rise and set every day, but to move completely through the stars, the background of stars, and come back to that same point in that path takes 365 days. So if we have the moon here and the sun here, and we have our solar eclipse, 2 weeks after that, the moon will have moved around to this side of its orbit, and it will be at that other node. But in that two-week period, the sun will move very little on its path. So when we arrive at that full moon phase, we're still in a pretty good straight line alignment. And so it's possible for us to have a lunar eclipse 2 weeks after the solar eclipse, or 2 weeks before the solar eclipse. And on August 7th of this year, so 1 week ago, we did have a lunar eclipse. We didn't see it from here because we were on the day side of the Earth when it was occurring. So by the time the Earth rotated around, the moon had moved out of our shadow, and we just observed a regular full moon. The folks over in Asia, in Africa, Australia, they got to see a lunar eclipse. So we'll get to see one of those in 2019. But the point is, because of these two nodes, you often have one type of eclipse, and then 2 weeks later you have the other type. Final thing. I don't know if you noticed this little note down here, but these objects and distances are not to scale. That's not entirely true. The moon and the Earth, that's a pretty good scale comparison. It's about a 1-4 ratio there. The sun is going to be much larger. Does anybody know how many times wider our sun is as compared to the Earth? I like that number 400. We'll talk about that number in just a moment, but that's a little too high. It's a nice round number, though. Anybody else? 200's a little bit too high still. It's about 100. It's somewhere between 100 and 110. Now, the distances are not to scale. I forgot to get out my little model. Give me 1 second here. Grab my model. All right. So to talk about the distances, we have a fun little demo up here. I love this model because has a folding yardstick, which I've never seen before, until I had one of these models. Really handy. All right. It's mounted on here. Sorry, I completely forgot about this, my setup. All right. So at the 0 point of my yardstick, I'm getting the light here where you can see it a little bit better, I have a 1-inch diameter Earth. So on this scale, how wide would my moon be? Be a 1/4 inch. There it is, right on top of that stick. Okay, so if you look at the shadows, you'll see a little bit better comparison there. It's kind of hard to see these little balls if you're far away. But that's a good size comparison. On this scale, how far would my moon have to be from my Earth? Any guesses? And I'll give you a hint. Somewhere on the yardstick. Some people will say, way out there in the yard. A little bit too far.
4 inches.
I heard 4 inches. Anybody else?
10.
10? There's 10. Anybody agree? Looking good to everybody? Anybody else? 15, that's our largest number so far. It's about there. You actually have to double it. So you have to go out to about 30.
So on average, the moon will be about 30 inches from our sun on this scale comparison. Or a good way to remember it, the moon is separated from the Earth by 30 Earth diameters. Now again, that's on average, because the moon is orbiting in an elliptical orbit around the Earth, and so it changes its distance. The past few years, we've had a lot of hype in the media about the supermoons. So that's when we have a full moon and the moon is a little bit closer to the Earth. So at that point, it's all the way up at about 28 and a half. So not moving much, okay? But it will make the sun, or excuse me, the moon appear just slightly larger in the sky, even though your eye won't be able to really pick that out. It is technically larger. Or it could be as far away as 32 inches. So it's not a huge change in distance, about a 10% change. But that will play a part in eclipses, as we'll talk about in just a moment. On this scale, how far away would our sun be? Yeah, so now, let me turn it here. So yeah, now we're talking about going out in the yard there. In fact, it would be past the building out there. It'd be about 1,000 feet from us. And it'd be about 9.5 feet in diameter. All right. So again, a fun little demo here. If you had trouble seeing, can't quite get them on the screen there. Yeah, there we are. So there's our Earth, there's our moon, scaled correctly in size and distance. Not what I was wanting here. All right, so eclipses are not rare. We have them about every 5.5 months. That could be a lunar, that could be a solar, it could be both. So here are the eclipse paths for the years 2001 to 2020. And in blue, we have the paths of the total solar eclipses, which you'll see here's the path for the 2017 eclipse going right through the US. In red are the paths of the annular eclipses. Those happen about half the time, and the total eclipses occur about half the other half. Let me show you what an annular is. That's an annular eclipse. So in this type of eclipse, the moon is near its farthest point in this orbit from us. So it appears physically smaller in our sky. So at that point, it cannot completely cover the disk of the sun. And these types of eclipses get their names from the fact that the sun looks like a big annulus or a big ring in the sky. This is not an annual solar eclipse. It does not occur every year, okay? But they're not that rare. But again, this is just because the moon is too far away in its orbit to be able to completely cover the sun. Now the moon is gradually spiraling away from the Earth at the grand rate of about 1.5 inches per year. And that's current rate. The reason it's doing that is because the moon's gravity is constantly pulling on the Earth. We have a very irregular surface, we don't have a uniform density, and so as the Earth is rotating and the moon's orbiting around us, its gravitational pull is tugging on those irregularities and it's slowing us down, just very, very gradually, less than a second per 1,000 years. Okay, so that's not much of a change in our rotation rate, but that energy of our rotation has to go somewhere. So it goes into the orbit of the moon and causes the moon to spiral out very, very gradually. So given enough time, about current calculations say about 600 million years or so, those 1.5 inches, which that'll decrease over time, but that changing distance will add up. And at that point, about 600 million years from now, the moon will never be close enough to the Earth again for us to ever have another total solar eclipse. All solar eclipses will be annulars like this one, or partials, where the moon goes through part of the sun. Let me go back here. All right, so again, this is the, for two decades, 2001 to 2020. Here are the next set of solar eclipses for the next two decades. Don't be thrown by the fact that the paths near the poles are very stretched out. That's an effect of the map projection. Okay, so Antarctica looks much larger than Asia, even though it's much smaller. And then here are all of the total solar eclipses for the years 1001 to 2000. And again, don't be thrown by these big areas down here. Those are actually very small. But you'll see that most of the, for all intents and purposes, basically the entire Earth is covered in these paths. Given enough time, you will experience a solar eclipse or a total solar eclipse from your viewing location. So if you're in the path of totality, like we will be on August 21st, on average, it'll be about 360 to 400 years before you experience another total solar eclipse from that exact same spot. You'll experience a lot of partial eclipses in that period, but to experience a total eclipse is much rarer. So let's just talk for a second about the lunar eclipses.
Excuse me one second.
All right, so the total lunar eclipses. So again, we have one of these in 2019 that'll be visible from the US. This was a sequence of images I got about 15 years ago of a total lunar eclipse, or its progression into a total lunar eclipse. In this image, which was taken first, this portion of the moon is actually shaded up here. This portion is in the penumbra of the Earth. So if I was standing on this portion of the moon, looking back towards the sun, I would be witnessing the sun partially blocked out by the Earth, or a partial solar eclipse. But if I was down here, I'm in the deeper, darker shadow of the Earth, or the umbra, and I would experience a total eclipse there. So about an hour later, I took these images. The moon is moving this way down into the umbra of the Earth. So once it was completely in the umbra, I brought up the exposure, and you can see that the moon is definitely darkened, but it's also taking on this beautiful red hue. And that's because of our atmosphere. If we did not have an atmosphere, the moon would have basically been black. But our atmosphere is really good at scattering blue colors of light. So as all the colors of the rainbow come in from the sun, the bluer colors get scattered by the nitrogen and the oxygen. Okay? And those scattered photons of light illuminate our sky and make our sky appear blue. So it's not a reflection of the ocean or anything like that that causes our blue sky. It's the composition. So the redder colors are able to get through. You see this effect very, very well at sunset because you're looking through the thickest part of our atmosphere then. Because there's so much more air that we're looking through near sunset because we're looking across the horizon, basically all of the blue light gets scattered out and you only see the redder colors coming through. And you'll see that effect for anything rising and setting. Okay, even the moon will look very red when it's first rising or just about to set. So if you're standing on the moon looking back at the Earth, you see the Earth completely silhouetted but surrounded by this beautiful glowing orange-red ring. So you're seeing all of the sunrises and sunsets on the Earth all at once. So some of that light is actually able to make it completely through our atmosphere, go back out into space. The atmosphere bends the path of the light just a little bit, kind of like a lens, and that diverts the light towards the moon. So that illuminates our moon during a total lunar eclipse. If the moon happens to go through a penumbral shadow only, then we have the penumbral lunar eclipse. And so these aren't dramatic. In fact, a lot of these, if you did not know that they were occurring, you would not notice them at all. Okay? So this is like a maximum eclipse here. And notice you can see the shaded part of the moon really, really well still. Now onto the solar eclipses. So this is a nice sequence of a partial solar eclipse. So the moon is moving this way in its orbit from west to east across the sky. So this would have been the first image, that would have been the last image down there. Pretty much all of the US is going to see more of the sun obscured on August 21st than what we're seeing here. In fact, most of the US will see about 75% or more of the sun obscured during our solar eclipse in a week. Now during totality, that's when you have to be in the path of that inner shadow, that very narrow path. During totality, that's when you really witness the truly spectacular type of eclipse. So what you're seeing here, obviously, is the silhouetted moon completely covering the sun. This glowing haze around it, this is known as the corona. So it's a very, very thin gas. It's about 1 million to 2 million degrees Celsius. Very, very hot. It's because of that very high temperature, it's ionized, which means it's going to be attracted to magnetic fields very, very well. So this gas, the structure in this gas, you can see what look kind of like hairs coming off the poles of the sun. That's the magnetic field of the sun. And it's changing constantly. The sun is a big ball of gas. It's rotating at different rates depending on the location that you're looking at. So that magnetic field is constantly getting changed and twisted. And so you can see kind of a larger structure here, kind of like a flame shape, and that's those magnetic field lines confining that gas.
Is that an actual photo?
This is an actual photo. Now this one has been enhanced to really bring out the detail. So if you've just set a camera down and, you know, put the telephoto lens and snap one image, you're not going to get something like this. Okay. This takes multiple exposures and a lot of processing to really bring out the subtle details of it. So even looking at it naked eye, you're not going to see this really fine structure. In fact, let me fast forward. So this was an image taken in 2003 in Antarctica when totality was occurring at sunset. This is more or less what you would expect to see. Now, because of that scattering effect, that the corona looks much oranger than what it will on August 21st. But you can really see that there is some larger structure here. There's a big lobe there, one there, just kind of a gap here. That's more or less what you could expect to see on August 21st.
Would you see any movement?
You're really not going to see any movement. Now, if you could be in the path of totality for, let's say, an hour or so, then you might be able to see some very gradual movement. Because you have to remember that our moon is about 2,000 miles wide. And somebody earlier, when we were working with the model, mentioned that the sun was 400 times larger than the Earth. It's 400 times larger than the moon, but it's 400 times farther away. So from our viewpoint, the moon and the sun typically look to be the same size in the sky. But our sun is almost a million miles wide. Okay, and so these structures here are about at least a million miles in length there. And so you would think that you'd be able to see some movement, but just because of the enormous size of it, it would take a while for you to see any changes. But given enough time, you would see some change. In fact, some of the sun-observing spacecraft like SOHO or the Solar Dynamics Observatory, they're constantly monitoring the corona. And you can see time-lapse videos over the course of a few hours, and you'll see this corona's changing, particles are going out into space. But you're not going to expect to see any movement on the 21st. Now, standing on the Earth looking back, or standing on the moon looking back at the Earth, you would see the moon's shadow going right across the planet. Only takes it a few hours to traverse that 8,000 miles. Now, it looks like the shadow's just up in here, but Australia was experiencing a partial eclipse down here. Okay, so that penumbra is much larger. You're seeing the very inner portion of that penumbra as well as the umbra up there. But the other parts that are much lighter, you're not seeing that very subtle shading. Here's another animation from that same eclipse. This one I really like because you can see the glare of the sun and the Earth's ocean there. Let's try it one more time. So that shadow is moving a little over 2,000 miles per hour relative to the Earth. That's because of the moon's orbit around our planet. And we'll come back to that in just a second. So on August 21st, all of the continental U.S. will have an opportunity to see at least a partial solar eclipse. But there's about a 75-mile-wide band that goes from one side of the U.S. to the other in which you will observe the total eclipse. Nashville happens to be the largest city in the path of totality, and there are some other big cities like Salem, Oregon, Charleston, South Carolina, part of St. Louis, the southern part of the city, St. Louis, Missouri, is in the path of totality. But if you're in the prime spot, which is from around Gallatin up through the center of the path to Hopkinsville, you can see about 2 minutes and 40, maybe 2 minutes and 42 seconds of totality. Throw some fun numbers out at you. This is the first time ever that Nashville will have witnessed a total solar eclipse, downtown Nashville, I mean. Because the last one to have a path of totality going over the downtown area was 539 years ago. So well before even Europeans had made it over here to discover the New World. The next one will occur on August 16th of 2566, about 549 years from now. It'll be the first time that we've had a total solar eclipse visible from one side of the U.S. to the other. The last time that occurred was in 1918. So given 100 years, we've built up our infrastructure. Now people are able to travel around very easily through the U.S. So one reason that this eclipse is special is now a huge population. At least 80% of the U.S. population is within a day's drive of that path of totality. Okay, so a lot of people are going to be moving that day. A lot of those people are going to be coming towards Nashville as well. So we could have a million to several million people coming in. We don't really know yet. First time since 1979 that a total solar eclipse has been visible from the mainland U.S. And that path went up through the northwestern portion of the country. And then the last one to be visible from U.S. soil occurred in 1991. That one passed, that path of totality went right over the Big Island of Hawaii, where we have some of the world's largest telescopes, which weren't capable of viewing the sun. But at least one of those was outfitted with the special filter that was made for that eclipse, so they were able to observe it. So what can you expect during totality? So the sky is going to darken dramatically. If you on the next clear night, if you go out about 8 o'clock, maybe 8:15, look at how dark it is. That's about what you can expect. It's not going to be like midnight, okay? But you will see a significant darkening. It's going to be much darker than just a really, really cloudy day.
Yes?
This will be about 1:30 in the afternoon when the sun is like almost as high as it's going to get for the day. That's when it's going to be really dark out. The temperature may drop anywhere from about 10 to 20 degrees Fahrenheit in just a few minutes. Some animals may behave differently. Most people notice the birds behaving a little bit differently. Roosters tend to crow in the past totality. There was a total eclipse observed by one of the volunteers at the observatory. He observed it from a bluff overlooking one of the sounds of Nova Scotia. So he was at the sea edge. And he said that as totality was just about to occur and was occurring, all of the seabirds were flocking inland to go roost for the evening. Then a few minutes later, after totality had passed, and the sky began to light, and they all went right back out again. Planets and stars would become visible to the unaided eye. And we'll talk about where to see those. And then finally, some features of the sun will be visible. We've already talked a little bit about the corona, but there are other things known as prominences that you may be able to see that day. And we'll talk about some other effects that you might notice as well. So this is a nice animation that's put out by NASA showing the path of that shadow across the US. So now we're seeing the penumbra. There's the end of that umbra. So if you're within this area, you see at least 90% of the sun obscured. So that umbra hits Salem about 12:10 our time, goes across the U.S., only takes it about 90 minutes to completely traverse our country, hits us about 1:30 our time, and then, let's see, I think it's about 20 minutes later, or no, 10 minutes later, between 10 and 20 minutes later, hits Charleston. So that shadow, again, is moving about a little over 2,000 miles per hour, but the Earth's rotation is in the same direction as that shadow is moving. So the Earth's rotation helps keep us in that shadow for longer than if we were just sitting still. So right now, we are moving about 700 miles per hour just because of the rotation of the Earth. So relative to the ground, we will see that shadow coming over us at about 1,400 miles per hour. Still twice the speed of sound, but that's better than three times the speed of sound. One of our friends is going to be in a jet that day, flying in the path of totality. So if there are any clouds, I hope we're getting the rain and the clouds out of the way today. But if there aren't any clouds, he'll be above them, flying in that path. And so he'll get a little bit longer time. I think it's a little over 3 minutes of totality. The Concords, they had flown in a path of totality at least once before, and so they got something like 90 minutes of totality. Because they were moving it pretty close to the speed of the shadow itself. So again, here is the path going across the U.S. You have to be in that shaded band in order to see totality. One thing we've really been trying to emphasize is that you can't just be close. You've got to be in it. 1,000 feet may make the difference. The blue band, or the blue line here, represents the center of the path, where you would observe the longest totality for your area. Now, because of the curvature of the Earth is kind of curving away from the moon, which means that Salem, people in Salem, are going to be a little bit farther away from the moon than what, let's say, people in Tennessee are going to be. And so they will see the moon just a little bit smaller, and so totality be just a little bit shorter for them. So the absolute best place to be would be right about there, but you may only get, you know, technically a half a second more than the areas right around there. So don't feel that you need to travel up that way. I would not recommend it. So GreatAmericanEclipse.com and also the NASA 2017 Eclipse website have maps of totality for every state in which that path crosses. So this is a blow up of Tennessee. So if you're right in the center here, you get about 2 minutes and 40 seconds. So Gallatin, they get right at that. Carthage, right on I-40 there, it gets about 2 minutes and 40 seconds. Downtown Nashville, can't really see the number up here, but they get right at 2 minutes. Now the observatory, if you see the dot for Brentwood, we're at about the 10 o'clock position, right on the edge of that dot. And so even being that close to the path, we theoretically get about right at 1 minute. You would think it'd be much smaller than that. But if you go on down to Franklin, then you're outside the path. In fact, Cool Springs is right in here, they're outside the path. So literally going from Cool Springs about 5 miles north, that gets you into the path of totality, and you have about a minute.
It's a Concord Road.
Concord
where
Road.
The library is about where it runs.
Yeah, so this line theoretically hits right where Concord Road and I-65 intersect. And so you have maybe a couple of seconds of totality there. But moving just a little bit towards the center, literally like a, just 2 miles, that gets you from a second to a minute of totality. Okay. Then going from, let's say, Brentwood all the way up to here gets you another minute, but then going from here all the way up to here only gets you about 40 seconds. So if you're near the edge, it will really benefit you greatly just to move a tiny bit. And there are also uncertainties at exactly where these lines are going to go. Okay. So if you're, I mean, right on the edge of that, do yourself a favor and move just a little bit in so that you can make sure that you're in that path of totality, and you're also going to increase your time. The path goes right over all these major interstates, so you can expect that during totality, the interstates are just going to be a literal parking lot. A lot of people are already going to know what's going to be happening, so they're going to get out on the interstate, pull off to the side, which is you don't want to do that because emergency vehicles have to get by, but not going to be able to prevent that, and also other people are just going to stop in the middle of the interstate, more than likely, and get out and watch this. And you've also got to expect that folks coming through are probably not going to know, you know, if they're at just the right time, they're going to be going through totality, they're not going to realize what's going on. It's going to be much darker than what it is out here today. It's not going to be like a regular cloudy day. It's going to be significantly darker.
The observatory, excuse me.
Yes.
Not as familiar as we should be, but the observatory is right off of Granny Line, isn't that correct?
Yes.
Right.
So,
right a little bit north of Old Hickory.
Yes.
Can you repeat
so, if you're just a little bit north of there, which is where we're planning to be, is the observatory expected to be total?
So, when I was saying earlier that we're at about the 10 o'clock position of that dot, I was speaking in reference to the observatory. Yeah. So, the question was, you know, if you're at the observatory and maybe you're a little bit north of that, what kind of totality will you get? So theoretically, we should have, and I say theoretically because there are always uncertainties in the times and the exact positions, but you know, we're just north of Old Hickory Boulevard where Granny White Pike intersects, so we should have right at a minute of time of totality there. And so if you're just a little bit to the north, especially northeast of that, then you should definitely have at least a minute. You may have a minute and a half. There is at the end I'll show you at least one website where you can find your location and it'll calculate with uncertainties how much time you get. I would say with uncertainties, because you don't want to be right on the line and say, well, according to the map, I'm technically in the path, I should be fine. You know, there's, it could be a half mile off.
Will you have a partial eclipse then?
You would have a partial eclipse, and you may see some other effects, or at least one other effect if you're right on that line.
Okay, like here in Franklin.
Here in Franklin, you'll definitely have a partial eclipse. You will not see totality. You are too far south. But again, you're not that far totality. I would not recommend taking the interstate. I would recommend, if I was doing it, I would leave very early that morning. Maybe like 6, 7, give me 6 hours to get in path, because you don't know what traffic is going to be like, because some people may, or there may be a lot of people that say, oh, everybody's going to be on the interstate, I'm going to be sly and I'm going to get on these back roads. And then, I mean, I was coming down, I can't remember, Old Hillsborough Pike, and the traffic was just from rush hour, it was backed up literally a couple of miles.
Yeah.
So you can expect that. You might want to just ride your bike. Then you won't be stuck in traffic. But if you are planning on traveling anywhere, it is recommended that, especially if you're going to be riding anywhere in a car, have food and water in the car, because you may get stuck on the interstate all day long. And it may be really hot that day, and you don't want to be stuck there and not have anything to drink.
Wow.
So be prepared.
And a full tank of gas.
And a full tank of gas. I would probably do that a couple of days before, because all the people coming in, and other people may say, oh, with all these people coming in, I better get gas. I'm actually going to have a gas shortage. We don't know. Okay. I'm sorry?
Take a portalette with you.
Take a portalette. Yeah, have some toilet paper in the car. So here are some times, and these are also on the information sheets that we had available. They're on the website as well, so you don't have to worry about writing them down. But when you have your solar eclipse glasses on, starting just before noon, these are for downtown Nashville, so these will be pretty much the same times for going all the way down to Smyrna and Murfreesboro. But around 11:58, you just start to notice a very tiny portion of the right side of the sun disappearing as the moon just begins to move in front. It'll take about an hour and a half for the moon to get completely in front of the sun. But by about 1:27, you'll see an extraordinarily thin crescent of the sun. And that's when you really need to get ready to remove the glasses, because these have to be on when any part of the sun is visible. But once the moon completely obscures the sun, you have to take these off, okay, and look straight up at the sun. The corona is not going to hurt your eyes. It's only as bright as the full moon. If you have these on during totality, in this 2 minute period, then you will not see the grand show. Okay? And you might as well just be sitting inside watching TV or something, okay? So, we have about 2 minutes for Nashville, and then it'll be another hour and a half of partial eclipse afterwards as the moon is moving out from in front of the sun. So if you're going to take pictures of the eclipse, partial eclipse is the best time to do it, because you've got an hour and a half. You can take your phone and put it up behind your glasses, take a picture. You can get filters for your cameras. You have to have a filter on your camera. Okay? You'll damage your camera if you don't. And plus, even a very thin crescent sun is incredibly bright. Okay? 1% of the sun's surface is literally 10,000 times brighter than the full moon. So your camera won't be able to expose that short of an exposure anyway. So you have to have the filter for the partial eclipse. You could take the filters off of your camera and try to get pictures of totality, but we really recommend against it. Just because if you had 20 minutes of totality, all right, it takes a minute or two and play around with your camera, but you've got precious seconds to view this total eclipse. You need to stand there and really take it in with your eyes, okay? And there are other things you're going to want to be looking for as well. You don't want to spend all that time fumbling with the camera. Plus, to get any decent shots, you have to take more than one image. So for instance, again, this was multiple images, okay? And you have to make sure your focus is good. Let somebody who's done this before and knows the tricks of the trade, let them waste their time and take the images and then get their image, okay? But you want to experience this.
Do you have pictures like that at the observatory for purchase?
We don't have them for purchase, but all of the images that I'm showing you here are free to the public. okay, or publicly available, I should say. There are places online where you can get prints of these. You could take some of them. You have to, you can take some of these and just, you know, take them down to Kinko's or wherever and print it. Okay. Yeah.
Totality occurs and we take our glasses off and we've got those precious 2.5 minutes, do we have to be careful about when the sun's going to pop back out?
So when the sun pops back out, in fact, let's go ahead and skip to this movie. So this is a live, well, obviously not live, but I mean it's a true ray, it's not a time lapse, I should say. So this is that 2015 eclipse. Started out the talk with that picture. So the right now, it looks like it's full sun, but that is about a 99% obscured sun. Okay. If you look over on the right side of the screen, you're going to notice that side is a little bit darker. What you're seeing over there is that umbra approaching. So these guys, they've got cameras ready. They've still got filters on their cameras right now, but now you can start to see it's really beginning to get darker over there, and you can start to see where the shadow is now leaving this part of the sky, and it's getting oranger. So we'll let this run. It's only a couple of minute video, but you can see how quickly that is changing. Now that last little bit of sun is going down. That last few seconds where you saw that diminishing, that's, if you run that in reverse order, that's what you'll see at the end of totality. So it's not going to be like all of a sudden this, you know, if you're looking up at the sun, you see this, you're going to start to see this bright spot forming, but it's not going to be like, bam, full sun. You're going to say, oh, there's the bright spot, I need to look away, put my glasses on. Okay. So now we've got the corona visible, which the camera is overexposing because it's seeing all of this darkness here, so it's hard to see the silhouetted moon. But you can see Venus right there. I forget what totality was for this particular eclipse. It wasn't that long, but let me speed it up just a bit here, and you can see the shadow moving across. So now the camera's trying to adjust the exposure. All right, so there, actually, let me back it up just a couple of seconds. All right, so here comes the end of totality. You start to see that bright spot reemerging. So now these guys are quickly putting the filters back on the cameras. And so now you can see this part of the sky is darkened. If you've got a good northwestern view, just before totality, you look to the northwest, you'll see that shadow coming towards you. And once totality ends, look to the southeast, you'll see that part of the sky is dark as the shadow is moving away from you.
So if we're not in a totality area, will we be able to see something like this?
You'll see that portion of the sky is darker, but, I mean, yeah, you just won't experience the totality part. Yes?
How come it appeared like a round sun the whole time? It didn't look like it was obstructed like you do in a lunar eclipse.
Because of the exposure of the camera. So So the camera is looking at different parts of the field and trying to adjust to get the best exposure. And so it's having to bring up the exposure, which is making the sun look like this bright ball, when in fact it was like we saw in that first view, that very first image that I showed with the ice fields and everything. So right now, I mean, again, only a very, very thin crescent of the sun is visible over here, but it's overwhelmingly bright, just that one little bit.
So if we're looking through our glasses as it's approaching, we will actually see the shape of the moon come across the sun?
Oh, yes. We'll and so, like a minute before totality, the sun, when you're looking through these glasses, will look like a really, I mean, super thin crescent. Mm-hmm. And as totality is just about to hit, you're going to notice that, so if you imagine the tips of the crescent being like little horns, mm-hmm. those tips are going to start drawing towards one another. You're going to have the last little bit of sun wink out. You're not going to see anything in here. That's when the corona is visible. Yeah.
And then how high in the sky will this be?
So the sun is going to, it's very fortunate for us because the sun is going to be really nice and high. I mean, it's almost at its noontime position. Okay, so you don't have to worry about finding a clear horizon. The sun is going to be nice and high. Just make sure that you don't have any big trees that are going to get in your way if you're setting up camp early in the day. During totality, street lights will likely come on. So don't set up right next to a street lamp. move away from it a little bit, because that street lamp will rival the brightness of that corona, and it'll make it much harder to see.
A parking lot is not a good place.
You can do a parking lot. Just don't stand right under one of those lights. Okay. So if you've got one of the big lights on a pole here, just move a few feet away to where there's at least a little bit of distance between it and the sun. So you don't have to move like a mile down the road. Before I get to this, as totality is approaching, about a minute before, if you set out like a big white piece of paper, or just some uniform light surface, as the sun is becoming more and more of a point in the sky, you're going to start noticing this effect. It's called shadow bands. You'll see it a little bit more prominently here in just a minute. So if you've ever watched the bottom of a swimming pool on a sunny day, you see those bright ripples. So as the water's moving around, it's easily bending the sunlight. The atmosphere does the same thing, but because it's so much thinner, it's much harder for it to bounce the sun's light around. Okay? But as the sun becomes a point source, it's much easier to bounce a point source image around. So that's what you're seeing here. You're seeing the air currents in our atmosphere. So we're about 10 seconds out. At about 5 seconds out, you see something called the diamond ring effect. So now we're in totality. Okay. And you'll notice in that last 30 seconds how quickly things darkened. Okay.
That's not laid flat.
So this one, these folks were seeing totality more towards sunset. And so they needed to have their screen up. Because we have totality when the sun is really nice and high, if you just lay it up like a piece of poster board, white piece of poster board would be great. Just lay it out there, and you'll start to see that about a minute before totality. And don't just keep staring at that, because the last 5 seconds, this is what you see. So this is known as the diamond ring, where you've got less than 1% of the sun's surface still visible. You should not look at that directly, though. Okay? Just kind of look off to the side. But now that this is before totality, the moon's moving this way, so this is about to wink out. And again, it's only about 5 seconds before totality starts that this occurs. This spot is now small enough and dim enough that it's not able to wash out this beautiful corona. So now the corona becomes visible, and looks like a big ring in the sky, and that last little bit of sun crowns it like a diamond.
Do we have our glasses on at this point?
At this point, I would. So the way I'm planning on doing it, about a minute out of totality, I'm probably going to take my glasses off. I'm not looking straight up at the sun. I'm just getting ready for that last little bit of sun to wink out. Mm-hmm. So I'll be looking. I'll use my peripheral vision to try to keep checking for the corona. Now, once the corona becomes visible, again, I'm not going to be staring directly at this, but I'm going to be looking off to the side to see this beautiful corona. So, which by then, you're going to hear people screaming and hollering like you heard on here. It's a truly incredible sight.
I'm going to scream.
I don't know if I'll scream. I'll just. You never know.
Yeah. When the diamond disappears, when you can look at it with the
naked eye. Yeah, so when that, again, this only lasts for about 5 seconds because the moon is moving that way. And once that last little bit disappears, then you just look straight up at this. The corona will be brighter because that last little bit of sun. If you have glasses on, hold the eclipse glasses over your regular glasses, okay? And then during totality, take them off, look straight up at this. Okay. Now, let's see here. If you're really near the edge, you tend to see this effect, which is a lot of those little diamonds, but you tend not to see the corona as well, because all of these little diamonds, their brightnesses add up. And what we're seeing here is the irregular edge of the moon. So near the edge of totality, the edge of the moon and the edge of the sun are literally like just lining up. Because of that irregular edge of the moon, you have mountains, you have valleys in between the mountains. These are little bits of sun, the sun's surface poking through those valleys and the mountains. So So these are known as Bailey's beads. Okay, they're named after Sir Francis Bailey, who was really the first one to report about them. You should not look at these bright spots, though. Now, you may notice and this especially occurs near the edge, you may notice that the edge of the silhouetted moon or the eclipsed sun looks kind of like an electric pink. So that's the lower atmosphere of the sun, known as the chromosphere. So again, this is a really nice totality, but the thing about this image, notice these little pink things sticking off. And there's kind of a blow up of some of them over here. Those are prominences. They look very small, but those are enormous clouds of gas that are being lofted up by the sun's magnetic field. So like this one here, that would easily be about twice the size of the Earth. You may see some of those poking out around the edge of the sun, or around the edge of the moon that day.
And you can't see that if when the sun is full. I mean, you have to, because it's being shaded by the moon, that's when we can actually see those. That's awesome.
She was saying that because the sun is shaded now, we're able to see these. Prominences, they glow in one color of red. It's called hydrogen alpha. It's not just any shade of red, it's one very specific shade of red. So the observatory has, and a lot of people have, what are known as hydrogen alpha telescopes. They're very expensive because they require a lot of very precise machining, but they will show you prominences on any day, even when there's no eclipse occurring. Okay, so on our open houses, if it's clear outside, we will set up our solar telescope and observe these prominences, because that type of telescope filters out every color of light except for that one shade of red. It's kind of the analogy that I use, it's like having a million different colored Christmas lights glowing all at once, and you're trying to see the light of this one particular red one. So this special type of filter blocks out all of that other light except for that one and allows you to see it. But the only time you can see this corona is during a total eclipse. There's no telescope that will show you this. All right, so now a little bit about safety. So again, we will have glasses to pass out today. These are not regular sunglasses. We've been asked, you know, can you use just regular sunglasses during the partial eclipse? The problem is regular sunglasses will not block out all of that UV and that infrared light, which is what damages your eye. The other thing that makes eclipses so dangerous is that you now have a reason to look at the sun. It's this nice eclipse, it's this nice crescent sun, but people try to find ways to dim down the light of the sun to where they can actually look at it. Thankfully, we have these built-in reflexes. You know, our eyes start to tear up, you feel kind of this pain around your eye if you try to stare at the sun, it forces you to look away and it preserves your vision. But if you dim down the sun's light to where you can actually stare at it, you're letting in a lot of this UV and this infrared, which will burn the back of your eye. It will literally burn the back of your eye. We've spoken to at least one ophthalmologist that has observed backs of people's eyes that have crescents burned into them because they were looking through the wrong kind of filter. But these types of filters, they are safe because they block out all of the UV and the infrared.
So they can be used to look at the sun at any time.
Exactly. So you can put these on any day. You can stare at the sun. In fact, there are often times where we have, or I shouldn't say often, but every now and then we will have large groups of sunspots on the sun. Okay. We put those glasses on, look up at the sun, you'll see this black spot on the sun. And as the sun rotates day after day, you'll see it appear to move. If you have those glasses, do not use an unfiltered telescope. If I were to point this telescope over at the sun, even though that's a small telescope, when it focuses the light into the eyepiece, that eyepiece will then burn right through those glasses. It'll melt the plastic in just a second or two. And then it starts burning your cornea, you do even more eye damage that way. Okay. If you're going to use a telescope, you have to filter the light before it gets into the telescope. These are great for observing the partial eclipse. You can even put your camera or your phone up to a telescope that's filtered and take a really nice view of the partial eclipse. We do not recommend taking the filters off during totality and looking towards the sun with the telescope. Now, you don't know the exact moment that little bit of sun is going to reemerge, and that tiny little spot, when you're gathering, when you're looking through a telescope, you're gathering maybe, depends on the size of the scope, but you can gather over 1,000 times as much light as what your eye gathers. So that little spot is now 1,000 times even more intense. So you can damage your eyes just with that tiny bit of spot emerging right after totality. Yeah, definitely don't stack a bunch of sunglasses. One of the old-fashioned ways was to use exposed film, especially X-ray film, because it's so dark. But again, it lets through infrared and ultraviolet, which is what does the eye damage. Same thing with smoked glass. That's even worse. One other way, you can get a welding glass of shade 14 or a higher number. Tends to give the sun a nice green color, but shade 14 will protect your eyes. Shade 15 will, shade 16 will, shade 13 will not. You typically have to get these online or at a welding supply store. Local hardware stores tend not to carry that high of a shade. Just a couple of other things, and then we'll end. If you do have a telescope that does not have a filter, and I would not recommend using an expensive telescope to do this because you do run the risk of damaging the scope. You can point the unfiltered telescope at the sun, this is the eyepiece, and mount a screen on the back. The advantage is you can show a lot of people all at once the partially eclipsed sun. You can even see sunspots, like there's one right there. Just make sure that you don't, or you have it set up to where small children or passersby can't inadvertently look up in that eyepiece. You can do pinhole projection. So take just a piece of cardboard, punch a hole in it, maybe just take a pencil and push it through to make that hole, hold the cardboard out, let the sun shine through, and so here's the shadow of that cardboard, but the hole will take on the shape of the partially eclipsed sun. And there are a lot of different ways you can do this pinhole projection. So this person took a colander outside, just held it out. If you're doing this with other people that aren't familiar with pinhole projection, make sure they don't try to look through the holes, because that will damage your eyes. You can use a lot of different things. Pegboard, I've seen people take a Ritz cracker, hold it out right next to a table, and the little holes in that will project.
Yeah. Can you not stand near a tree and get the same effect?
You can. So make sure to look under all of the trees as the partial eclipse is occurring. So you'll see just thousands of little images of the sun. So the final slides here, if any part of the sun's surface is visible, you have to have those glasses on. Right? Even 1 minute before totality, do not look up at the sun without those glasses on. But during totality, make sure that you take the glasses off. Again, this is only about as bright as a full moon. It is safe to look at straight on. Okay? Put the glasses on once that little spot begins to reemerge. Final slide, if it is cloudy like it was in Shanghai in 2016, this is just before totality, and that's during totality. So you'll still experience it, you just won't be able to see the sun, unfortunately.
Take a picture from your phone, let's say, through the glasses.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. And so the question was, can you take a picture through the glasses with your phone? You can. That's fine. Telescope manufacturers, they often have these filters that'll go on binoculars, even cameras. But once totality is occurring, then you would just point it straight up at the sun. Okay. But again, don't worry about taking pictures of the totality. Experience it.
What's your best guess on it?
I have no idea. I'm just going to leave it at that. I think the Farmer's Almanac says typically there's about a 40% chance of rain, but I don't know. So I'm not going to pay any attention to any weather forecast until about a day out. And I'm also going to start looking at the traffic forecast, because I'd like to move a little towards the center of the path if I could. I live out in Antioch, so I've got about a minute and a half, but I'm greedy and I'd like to get that 2 minutes if possible. But if it looks like, even Saturday or Sunday, the traffic is getting crazy, I'm just going to stay put. Yes?
Opinion, city versus rural, is it?
Not really going to be a big difference. Anybody else? So again, we do have the glasses. We've got a limit of one per person. We've actually got many more of these talks to do, so I've got to be stingy with the glasses. Yes?
The ones that we already have that have been given out,
yes.
Is there any way we can look at them to check to see if they're safe? Do they have some kind of writing on them?
It's a good point. Amazon has actually started sending out notices to a lot of people that purchase glasses from them that they don't know if the glasses are safe because they come from third-party vendors. Typically, the first thing to look for if you've got glasses already is to see if it has this thing about meets the ISO requirement.
ISO?
Yes. And it'll have a long number after that. So if yours don't have that on that, I would be very cautious. Probably just discard them because you don't know. But there are some people, unscrupulous people, that have been making these, putting that number on there, even though they are fake glasses. Okay. So the
where's a safe place to purchase those?
Unfortunately, now places like Walgreens and Kroger and Lowe's that have them, they're all sold out.
I got them the other day at Twice Daily.
Twice Daily, okay. So they have some.
They have the Adventure Science Center sponsored them.
Yes, Adventure Science Center. I think that they still have glasses for sale, and I think they've got a lot on reserve for Eclipse Day because they're doing a bunch of activities. One thing I want to point out. So here's the Dyer Observatory webpage. Just can't see the address. Dyer.vanderbilt.edu. Go to our web page, and the address is on that sheet we gave out. This is our Eclipse page, which has basically all of the stuff we talked about today. Okay. And let's see, one of the links that we have is about these fake glasses. So the American Astronomical Society has been compiling a list of vendors that they know have the correct glasses. Okay, they've actually had the lab tests done to make sure they do meet these ISO requirements. And there's a link to that growing list there. So if you're going to get glasses from a certain vendor, I would look there first to make sure that they're on that list. Rainbow Symphony and American Paper Optics, those are two main manufacturers, and they are good. In fact, these are from Rainbow Symphony here.
If you have those, you better check for scratches.
Yes, make sure that if your glasses have any scratches, well, if they get any scratches, you should discard them, or any little pinholes. So people often ask, you know, how do you know if there's a pinhole? Well, if you just kind of hold them out like that towards the sun, you'll see this bright little pinhole of light. You need to discard those. So we often just recommend folding them up, putting them in a little Ziploc bag. That'll help protect them.
Gosh, I can't tell you how informative that was this morning. Thank you, Dr. Steve.
One quick link here. So on our Eclipse page, if you find the sky map, which by the way I didn't get to mention where the planets will be, but you can look at this sky map to see where you'll spot the planets in the sky on totality or during totality. But right below that we have a bunch of links. These bottom two links, they are interactive maps where this bottom one you can even search for your address, but it will calculate the start and end times of partial and total eclipse. Okay, so that'll give you an idea of how much to expect. But again, if you're right on the edge, I would recommend moving just a little towards.
Yeah, I guess we're all going to Brentwood, huh?
Yeah.
All right. So great. Thank you so much for your time.
Yeah, you're very welcome. Yeah, and I'll be hanging around for a few minutes if anybody else has any other questions.
So just a reminder, Franklin tomorrow has these talks every second Tuesday. The next one is September the 11th. We really want to thank Vanderbilt and the Office of Neighborhood Government and Community Relations for sponsoring this and having it here at West Haven. And of course, Dr. Teese, for your time this morning.
Oh, my pleasure.
Absolutely.